y'all are. Good, good, good. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Y'all all right? Everybody all right out there? You okay? Jason, you doing good today? Hallelujah, man. Praise the Lord. You want to just praise the Lord with me today? Me and you going to praise the Lord today. Everybody else going to sit. Me and you going to praise the Lord today. I tell you what, it's good to be in the presence of God today. I'm telling you what, it's just a great place to be here. And I hope you're having a great Father's Day. And I hope if your pops is with you, that you just have a blessed time. Don't take it for granted. Every time's precious. Every moment's precious. And I tell you what, we've been very blessed here. Inside your bulletin today, you are going to notice some different things. Today is Boomerang Sunday, ain't it, Miss Sandra? Right? So they need to turn that in today. But if they're a little bit late, we'll take it anyway, won't we?
I think for the next few days.
Okay, for the next few days, y'all be putting them $100 bills up in there. Ain't that right? That's right. That's right. So anyway, it goes for the boomerang bottle, baby bottle boomerang. What it is a pregnancy crisis center right over here in Macomb. So somebody was asking me, well, what do you do with that? And I said, well, this helps people that are facing making decisions about abortion. It's one thing to say that I'm not for abortion. It's another thing to give an alternative. So if I believe that abortion is wrong, then I should reach into my pocketbook and pull out the money to help try to help somebody who has a need. It's worthy. It's worthy. So somebody says, you mean they still have abortion clinics? Yes. Yes. There's still abortion clinics. Over 1 million aborted babies a year. Now think about that. Just think about that. So anyway, so this is an opportunity that we have to be able to minister to that. I want you to remember that there's no night service tonight. Take time with your family. Also, I want to thank everybody who worked in Vacation Bible School, right? So you want to say anything about it? Jessica, stand up, say something. Give a whole speech now.
A big speech?
Because I know I'd give you time to prepare this now.
All right. Yeah. Number one, we could definitely not have done it without everybody's help. Even if it was, you know, praying for the Vacation Bible School, I think
yes.
It turned out really well. We had a great turnout. Leslie's my numbers lady, so she can tell you the numbers, but we appreciate all the help. And if would it be okay if you were able to help us during Vacation Bible School, would you stand up just for a minute? I'd love
just
to
a moment.
Just
you
acknowledge
stand.
That You were helping, and we appreciate it so much.
You helped in any way.
Would
you
stand? Any capacity,
anyway.
I mean,
anyway.
Every bit of it. We couldn't have done it.
Thank you. Thank y'all so much. You made a difference, and it was more than what we had last year, right? What was the total in attendance, the workers in?
That's a Leslie question, because I don't remember.
So we averaged 85. So that's a wonderful blessing. So, and hey. Working towards that direction it should be, you know. So I praise the Lord. It went really smooth. There was no stress involved at all, was it, Jessica? It was just so smooth. I appreciate it. And Jessica did a fabulous job, and all y'all did too. Also, let's see. Don't forget the nursing home ministry. And we're asking that every night at 8 o'clock, if you would take time to take 1 minute, 60 seconds. By the time you boot up your smartphone, you've done spent about half that time anyway, all right? So you turn it on. Take time to pray for your president, all your government leaders, your Supreme Court, because we need people that are prayer warriors serving the Lord. All right? I get all that right, Miss Carolyn? Everything okay? I'm doing it all right so far? Okay. Make sure my boss, we have it down pat right here. So we also want to recognize all our dads today. We want to recognize our dads, and we want to recognize some particular dads. You know, you have an important position in the body of Christ. You know, the main trouble with our country today, and I was looking at this statistic, I was absolutely amazed. Over 40% of all children are raised in a single-parent home. 40% of our children are raised in a single-parent home. And, you know, ladies have done a fabulous job, but I'm telling you, godly dads make a huge difference. It makes a difference in what really matters in our world today. And a lot of times us dads don't realize that our children are watching us so closely. You don't realize that they watch how you handle every situation. So if you just kind of just run away from everything, they see it. If they see you pray or not, They see it. They see if you go to the church or not. They see it. And this is how they measure the daughters. This won't sound good, but I'm going to say it anyway because it never did sound good in the first place. But, you know, dads, little girls look at their dads, and their future husbands, are, according to statistics, are somewhat like their dads. I know y'all are going to frown and all this kind of stuff like that. That's right. So I want you to think about this, dads. Are we representing how a husband should be in the first place? And then you got to look at sons. They look at dads as how a daddy should be. Have you ever thought about that? So it's so important what we do, because the little things do matter, because they measure themselves on how they should behave or how they should do things by dads a lot. Dads are really important. We're a lot different than everything else in the world. Dads are so important, and they leave an impression with your home, good and bad. So we want to recognize some dads today. So we want to see. So we're going to, the dad with the most children present here at the church right now, because I say this a lot of times, I get people confused, so I don't want to get anybody confused. If you have the most children present today, okay, so how many dads have at least two kids at church today? How many dads? There we go. We got some. Got a couple right there. Got at least two kids. Got at least two kids here today. Okay, so we got several of them. How many have at least three kids here today? Raise your hand up. I can't see. Raise it up in the air. Let me see. Way up in there. I see one right there. Is there any more? Is three the record today? Is that it? Stand up, my Jason. Stand up. Shout to the Lord. Hallelujah. And Miss Carolyn. We are proud of you. Thank you so much. So Jason has been on like the unending turnaround. He has worked 7 days a week, and he even come up here after he had worked all night. One night he'd come to church and everything. He was white as a ghost and everything. And he came to church and made an effort. He's fixing to switch over to his new job coming up shortly. But before he goes to his new job, which is at Exxon, he is going to be going to him and his wife to youth camp, him and her and Hannah. And they're going to be chaperoning our boys and girls at youth camp today. So you want to know, what are the young families doing? Well, they're doing it. Hallelujah. And we appreciate what they're doing there just greatly. And so it's just a wonderful blessing to see y'all working for the Lord. Also today, we want to recognize, what's the next one? Is the oldest one here? Is that the right one? I've got to make sure. I got to check with my boss down here. She'll knock me in the head. So how many dads do we have that are at least 75 years old here? Raise your hands up. You know, y'all got to remember, I'm getting old too. So, well, that's about half the congregation. Okay? Okay. Hallelujah. We're glad you're here. How many, we're going to jump this up, obviously, here. How many are at least 80 years old? At least 80. That's about 25% of the population right there. So how many, that's right. That's right. Thank you. You notice my brain ain't working today. I'm slipping. These are the wisest dads, not the oldest dads. These are the wisest dads. So how many of them are at least 82 years old? We still in that 25% range? Well, I kept seeing you, and I'm like, was he raising? No, I'm like, he's not much older. Brother James not much older than me. So how many are at least 84 years old? Raise your hands up. All right. How many is at least 85 years old? I'm wearing them out here. At least 85. Goodness gracious. How many is 86 years old? At least 86. We're big. We go one bit, whatever. 87 years old? At least 87 years old? At least, how about 88 years old? All right. How many is 86 years old? All right, so we got two at 88. We got two at 80. I'm sorry, I'm jumping around. I'm sorry, my brain ain't working today. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm in competition with you guys, I'm telling you. At least 88. Anybody 89? Anybody 89? We got two at 88. Hallelujah, Mr. Robert and Brother Marcel right here. Y'all stand. Can y'all stand? Are you able to stand, Brother Marcel? Can you stand today? You ain't got to if it hurts now. Brother Robert, stand up. Well, he's going to come to you. Once you get up that age, we're going to come to you now. I'm telling you, he's going to bring it back there to y'all. So Brother Robert was out there with his tractor the other day straightening out and the stuff in the fields and everything. And Brother Marcel was helping somebody. And did you crack something in your bone, a bone somewhere in your body? You got a spinal injury. And he drove himself to Jackson. Y'all wonder why I get stressed? I got one out there on a tractor in 90-some degrees, and I got another one out there trying to crack bones and stuff. Praise the Lord. What a blessing. What an example. What an example. Now, y'all know you get cracked bones, and Mr. Robert back there, you know, just tired, still at church serving the Lord. What an example. Oh, I pray I'm like that. If the Lord lets me tarry around here for a while, I pray I'm like that. So let's open. I want to pray today for these fathers, okay? Let's pray for all these dads today and just celebrate on this great day. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you sent some godly dads here, Father. I thank you so much for the ones that are present. I thank you so much, God. For, Lord, they set the example for all who will surround them. I pray today, Father, blessings upon each and every one. I pray strength and encouragement, Father, because, Lord, I know sometimes they all grow weary in doing good. But, Father, I pray that the Holy Spirit gives them strength, gives them the words to say, and may their testimony live on for generations to come about how great thou art, Father. I thank you, Father, that as Robert and Marcel, here it is in their 80s, Lord, have been serving you these many years. Both have been deacons, Father. Both have put their, Lord, their hands to the grindstone to make sure the message of Christ is spread. I pray, Father, that, Lord, even as we look around, that we could see ourselves in the reflection of how they've lived their lives. And that, Lord, we don't grow weary in doing good for your glory. Father, we pray that the Holy Spirit will move here in a powerful way today. That our eyes will be opened to the needs of dads. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen.
We've a story to tell. And if you're a Christian, you've got a story to tell. So I want everybody to sing on this song. Let's stand together as we sing. We've a story to tell.
Oh,
pray.
Y'all join with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord, thanking you for this opportunity. Lord, first of all, for the love that you show towards us through your Son, Jesus. Lord, that he would make that sacrifice on that dark day of Calvary, Lord, that we might have eternal life through your resurrection, Lord. We hold that in truth, Lord, and pray that the things that we say today here will bring glory to you. We thank you for this opportunity to come and worship. We pray, Lord, that your Spirit would come and join with us and dwell in us, Lord, to lead us to worship. We again thank you, Lord, for the fathers here today that are faithful in the truth, Lord, and spirit, that have come and joined for so many years. We have those that are well in age, Lord, to continue your service to the church. Lord, we are the body. We make up every part of it, Lord, and we just thank you for each man that is willing to serve you, to give their life to you, Lord, in service, and to go and teach their families, Lord, your ways from the Scripture. We again, Lord, thank you for the leadership in our church, Lord. It's each every one as we have went through this Bible school time for the young people. Lord, there's so many workers that put forth the time, and we thank you for that effort. But, Lord, we thank you most of all for the children that came, and, Lord, that would be able to share the truth in the Scriptures the way that was presented to them, that they would hold on to it and their life would grow in the nurture and admonition of your truth. We thank you, Lord, for our pastor, that you would provide the needs for him in each and every way, and his wife to support, Lord, the ministry here in this church and even in our community as they outreach to different places, Lord, that you would give them the word to share and the strength to share it. We thank you for our leadership and our song service, Lord, Brother Raymond, his faithfulness, Lord, that we would all sing the songs that would bring honor and glory to you and praise to you by the words of the hymns that are written for us. We thank you for the musicians, Lord, and we thank you for the missionaries that from the different groups that go out and to share your word in the lands that here in the United States, I say foreign, but it's the darkness in the dark lands that of our country. The lost will receive your word, and we just thank you for the strength that they have, that you provide for their needs, Lord. And as we continue in this service, Lord, that again, that each and everything we say and do will be to bring glory to Jesus. We thank you again for your love, Lord Jesus, that you have for us. May we show it from our church into our community. For your glory and thanksgiving, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Song is all that thrills my soul is Jesus. stand up for Jesus. And let's stand together as we sing this be our offertory hymn.
Thank you.
be a great day, isn't it? We'll meet each other over there. Brother James Sellers is going to bring us special music for us this morning. Where is he at? Oh, okay. Hey, you pull one on me there. You're sitting on the front pew there. I was looking for you on the back.
I move around a lot. Brother Raymond asked me to sing. I always get my old broad and hymnal out. There's some songs in it that not in that Baptist hymnal. I don't know who put that Baptist hymnal together, but they left out some good stuff. Father's Day. When I think of Father, I think of my Heavenly Father. If we're going to be good fathers, we have to pattern our lives after God. When I think of God's love, three words come to my mind. The word sacrificial, the word individual, and the word unconditional. God's love is sacrificial. He sent His Son, and Jesus died on the cross. If we are to be good earthly fathers, we have to be sacrificial, giving to our children, to our family, to our church. God's love is individual. My favorite chapter in the Bible, perhaps, is the 23rd Psalm, and David never used a plural. He always used a singular. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leaves me beside. I shall dwell in His house forever. God's loves each of us like we were the only person who needed loving. And then the word unconditional. Isn't it wonderful that God loves us in spite of who we are? I shudder when I hear a parent say to a child, "Well, if you are bad, God's not going to love you." Don't ever tell a child that. God loves us not because we're good, but He loves us because He's God, and God is love. And then I find, and you're going to have at least 10 minutes left to preach, preacher. God's love is expressed so beautifully in Luke chapter 15, where Jesus, and He so often did use parables to express love. He talked about a man who had two sons, and one of them wandered off, and he loved him back home. He talked about a woman who had 10 pieces of money. She lost one. She searched till she found it. He talked about a man who had 100 sheep, and he lost one sheep. And he left the 99 and he went looking for that one sheep. Listen to the words of this song that's centered around that parable from Jesus, the 99. There were 99 that safely lay in the shelter of the fold, but one was out on the hills away, far off from the gates of gold, away on the mountains wild and bare, the tender shepherd's care, away from the tender shepherd's care. Lord, Thou hast here Thou 99. Are they not enough for Thee? Shepherd made answer, "One of mine has wandered away from me, and although the road be rough and steep, I go to the desert to find my sheep. I go to the desert to find my sheep. But none of the ransomed ever know how deep were the waters crossed. dark was the night that the Lord passed through, ere he found his sheep that was lost. Out in the desert he heard its cry, sick and helpless and ready to die. Sick and helpless and ready to die. Lord, whence are the blood drops all the way that mark out the mountain track? They were shed for one who had gone astray, ere the shepherd could bring him back. Lord, whence are thy hands so rent and torn? They're pierced tonight by many a thorn. They're pierced tonight by many a thorn. But all through the mountain thunder ribbon, and up from the rocky steep, there arose a glad cry through the gates of heaven. Rejoice, I have found my sheep. And the angels echoed around the throne, rejoice, for the Lord brings back his own. Rejoice, for the Lord brings back his own.
Children's Church. You know, sometimes if you ever get discouraged, you just need to watch how many kids go to the back to stay in church. And look how many people try and tempt, and Leslie's been so faithful in just working with the kids because she want to offer something to the kids and where they could hear the Bible. I'm going to tell you, that's the most important thing, is that the children hear the Word of God. Because I'm telling you, everybody needs it. Were you listening to that song? Did y'all hear that? Now, I know some of you young people, because of tempo and stuff, it's almost like you automatically, if you're not careful, you'll turn off that thing. But did you hear the story? He was telling a story as they were going and sharing, and him was so perfectly timed how God was going after his own. I hope you listened to it. I tell you, we need to spend time listening to our elders. And Brother James at 125 is such a wonderful elder. I'm just making sure you're listening back there is what I'm doing. If you open your Bibles up to Ephesians chapter 6, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4, if you can stand with me and read God's holy word. You're almost right, Brother James. I got 15 that we're going to do it, though. Watch this. You preach the sermon, all I got to do is come and have an altar call now. It says, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. I'll be able to just do an altar call there, huh? That's enough. That's the preaching right there. Let us pray. Father, I thank you so much, God. Lord, what a blessing it is to be in your house today with all these men and women, Lord, and these young people and children, to be able to, Lord, speak the gospel message of Jesus Christ. I ask, God, that you would give me the words, give me direction, that, Lord, I would honor you with everything I say and do, for Father, it's all about you, the perfect Father. Lord, may we mimic you in all our actions and deeds. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. So I was reading this cartoon the other day, and it showed this little kid. He's out there, and he's digging taters with his pawpaw, and as he was digging taters out there, and he's been sweating. They've been out there a few hours just digging and getting them forks and throwing them taters on the side, and that little boy finally put his hands on his hips. He said, "Pawpaw, why in the world did you bury these things?" You know, that's so true today. Most kids don't even know where taters come from in the first place. You know, it's so important in what we do in our actions and deeds as dads and as families in the first place. And it's really, you know, you could preach like 5 hours on this, but you know, I know your ears will grow numb in about 2 minutes, so I only have just a little bit. But 48 hours did a show, this is years ago, and I was looking at this particular statistic, and what they were talking about was they were talking about these runaway dads. Now, we've already had several generations, so believe this, it's not just now, it's done been several generations where there hasn't been dads in home. Right now, the statistics show that over 40% of all American children are in a single-parent home. And they even glorified on your national news and stuff. And I know people are trying their best to do their best, but we don't take family responsibilities very big anymore. It was shown in there that 26, no one, let's just try to grasp this number, 26 million children do not have a dad that's in their house anymore. So the greatest need that's in America today is children that understand fathers. And I was reading like this, a couple of these children that, who didn't have dads, and they had some people that were adopting and picking up children and loving on these kids. But it was amazing to me how many of them said, "I have no relationship with my dad. I could care less if he's alive or dead because he really doesn't make a difference in my life." And that came from a child's mouth. And I was like, wow. I mean, are you missing this most important part right here? Well, we don't see where dads are needed anymore. Dads, you're important, and you make such a big difference in your society. If we would take it, the responsibility of being dad very sincerely into our heart. A lot of times, the only thing we need to do is we need to go out there and just make the money and bring it home. And then you see, you know, the women today, a lot of times they're doing the finances and they're doing the cooking. And they're also disciplining the children and they're bringing their children their children to church. A lot of kids have never really seen their dads in the church. They haven't seen them putting much importance in it. But it's important because what you do is going to make an eternal difference. Now, I don't know where you're at with your spiritual relationship with Jesus Christ, but I'm telling you, it's important to worship the one that you call God. It's important to glorify his name, because if you're truly saved, your heart has been created to be a worshiper. And when you're missing that in your life, you need to check yourself, because and this can be men or this can be women. If you do not have a calling in your heart to glorify God, and it doesn't matter the music style. We do old style. You know, I've been old style, new style, blended services. I've been in every single service. But I'm going to ask you this. Where is your heart at when it comes to worshiping the risen Savior? You see, your children are going by the example that they see you worship. They see what you put as important in life. Now, we all create our own bills. We all spend money the way we spend it. And if you don't get discipline in your life, what happens is everything else in life is running you instead of you controlling your life. And when you do that, you feel like you run ragged. You feel like, oh, my goodness, I can never catch up because there's no discipline there. You see, fathers, we don't see where it's the importance of what our positions are. And that's what you see all across the United States anymore. But one of the things you need to do as a godly father, we ought to be challenged to some responsibilities according to the scriptures right here. One thing we need to look at is that it ought to be important on how we raise our children up. You know, it's so easy if you're not careful to raise our children up with a difference. You know, within the last 25 years or so, I was watching some children one day, and I was watching them play and everything, and I was watching just the little girl off playing by herself, and I was watching how the family dealt with the son. And it's amazing how we raise our children sometimes, and we put so much emphasis on the son. And without maybe being really understanding what we're doing, we show favoritisms. And if we're not careful, even if you're not intentionally doing it, somebody feels like they're left out. In Scripture, it talks about some favoritisms where it talks about Jacob and Esau. So the dad, Isaac, he favored his son Esau, while Rebekah favored the Jacob. And what it did, what it do in the home? When you read the Scriptures, you see how it kind of split it right there. There was a typical jealousy. You see dads come up today, and you'll see them, well, I'm going to give you such and such, and I'm going to give you such and such. You need to shut up. Because I'm telling you, you need to evenly divide it so that your children feel evenly loved. You make the difference. You're the dad. You produced them. So it's important that you don't show a favoritism, because it can have a devastating effect in the home right there. It caused these two brothers to hate each other. I literally, and I know I've said it before, I saw a brother knock another brother out through a screen door over 1 acre of ground when the whole settlement was 1,000 acres. It was silly, because they didn't understand. One of them thought the dad loved one a little bit more. He said, well, I'm going to do what I'm going to do. That's right. You're going to do what you're going to do. But if you're not careful, you can cause strife in your family that can be so disruptive. When you look through there, you see how Jacob, how he learned a lesson. This guy had 12 sons, and his favorite out of all the 12 was his 11th son. And how did he show the favoritism? Even Dolly Parton sang "The Coat of Many Colors." People listened to that for years back there on country music and stuff like this. And that favoritism was shown, because as that kid was wearing that coat of many colors, all the others said, well, hey, my dad never did nothing like that for me. My dad never did buy nothing like that for me. And it caused a jealousy right there that was so disruptive in the home. We have a responsibility to treat our children, whether they're males, whether they're females, but to treat them the same. And that can be challenging, because normally we're drawn to one because of their personality or something like that. And you can be drawn. And if you're not careful, you start showing a favoritism to one of the children, and the kids pick up on that stuff pretty quick. One of the things we need to do is understand it's so important that we don't neglect our children. See, you got to remember, if we're not careful, we get so busy doing the things that aren't going to really matter when it's all said and done. You look back on your lives, guys. I'm 55 years old. So I've had different positions, and I've before I was a pastor, you know, I made a substantial amount of money, okay? And with that money, I look back on it and how much I worked. And my little girl wouldn't even come sit in my lap at 3 years old because I was always at work. What difference did it make? I'm going to tell you what it can make. It can make the difference where your child feels like that's their responsibility. It's just to get out there, and the ultimate goal is to make money. Now, we know we all have to make money. Every one of us have to make money. But there has to be a point where we control our lives and not life, all this other stuff controlling us. You see, we got to give the importance of giving that time. And giving that time is more than just going out there in recreation. Giving that time is listening to the communication with a child. It's our responsibility to protect these kids. We have to understand that there's dangers out here. Listen to me closely. Your children are more in danger now than probably the history of the world. Because right there at their very fingertips, we have given them these things, these cell phones, these smartphones, and they've already shown, they're already showing where the small children are being affected. It's rewiring their brain. Y'all happy with me right now so far? Everybody pretty, y'all loving me now, ain't you? Like, tell this dude, shut up. One of the things I actually like to do is I like to read. Might be why my eyes give me so much trouble anymore, because after I read so many hours, my eyes will go, I just can't see anymore. But as you read, you start seeing how, because these smartphones that keeps these children, it actually has caused, they show through I don't know if that's a CAT scan, MRI, I don't know about all that junk, but they were tracing it, and it shows it rewires your children's brains to be differently. So sometimes if we're not careful, we don't realize the dangers are sitting right there in front of us, and they look like they're harmless. It looks like it's just entertainment. It looks like it's something that can't damage our children. But let me ask you, and when you're a family home, how many of you sit down and have a meal together at the table? How many of you, even during the holidays, can sit down for 1 hour with your family without one person in that group having a cell phone? So is that controlling them, or are they controlling the phone? Ain't it amazing how we have these different things where pornography is just at the fingertip? And I don't care how great your kid is, how sweet your kid is, it's dangerous. It's like handling a cobra, because all it takes is one bite of the poison, and it can hurt them so badly. And none of you would want your children hurt. But it's so time-consuming to be a parent. It's so time-consuming going around and trying to take care of them. It's so time-consuming, and we have so many other things to do. But your responsibility's big. It's one thing to make a baby, and it's another thing to raise a baby. Anybody can biologically, you know, probably have some child, but can you raise that child to be an adult? Can you raise them with knowing where the dad is? You know, I was looking, and there's already several generations who don't know what a father should do in the first place because they never had one. And more than likely, a bunch of you probably have had this experience where you didn't have a dad present in your life. So all a dad is some guy who comes in sometimes and shows up every now and then, maybe drops a little money on the table. They don't understand because they haven't even looked in the scriptures. So it's so important. You can't be lazy as a father or a mother. So your children out here, when we're going along sometimes, if we're not careful, we can be so harsh and we can be so hard. Now, it's one thing, we should train them up. You can't let them just sit around and do nothing. You've got to train them up, but you also have to be an encourager. Y'all ever heard that scripture that you speak life and death? Life and death. And we don't take those words very, very serious. But when you're out there and you're speaking over your children, you're telling them things, you have the ability to tell them just how unique you are, how special they are, and that they have a gift. See, each one of us have a natural bend in our life. It talks about it over there in the scripture. It talks about that we have this natural bend of going in a different direction. It's not always where the moms or the dads want them to go, because we want them to be the little us and grow up to be the superstar of something. They've got to be the superstar. We would throw them under a railroad train as long as they get on TV, as long as they're famous. When the most important thing that you can encourage your children is to know Jesus Christ, their Lord and Savior. Because if they know, truly know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and they're studying that Word of God, they'll grow up to be a godly parent. And what we need in this generation is a parent that understands the responsibility of raising the children to be godly. The reason that everybody, you have people in the church today, is thinks, now watch, I'm going to offend somebody, but that's okay. That's why I make the big bucks. Is because they think it's a right to abort a child. It's a woman's body. Now I'm going to tell you, you got a body, but do you understand that that individual, God says, I knew you before you was formed in your mother's wombs. And unless you raise that children up to know that at the moment of conception, they'll grow up and sit in a church pew and say, it's okay. The reason people adapt to what the world says and what the TV says is because they have no biblical concept to stand back on. You hear people today saying, well, I'm a this or I'm a that. I'm a Christian, and I believe that it's okay to do these things. Can't be. God says that if you love him, you keep his commandments. And I'm not talking just the Ten Commandments. But throughout the scriptures, it talks about things that are considered an abomination. And one of the things is the god of Moloch, is they would used to, this is Old Testament, they used to take the babies as a part of their sacrifice when you had a child, and you would put this on this god that they created, and it would be have fire in it, and it would be made out of brass, and they would place the children there. They would sacrifice their children. We sacrifice our children for the concept of science so that we can get older. I said this the other day. Dying's not the hard part. Listen to me. If you're a born-again believer, dying's not the hard part. The hard part is living. The hard part is living. So we have to bring our children up in the fear and admonition of the Lord so that they understand the difference in right and wrong. Why do you think there's no concept anymore? You know, why do you think everybody acts and behaves the way we do? Good people, people I love. It's because there's no fear of the Lord. I'm not talking about the fear like this. I'm talking about that healthy respect. Just like when you raise them up like that, see, they respect their parents. When you raise them up with a healthy fear, they respect you so much that you don't have to worry about it. Now, when they become teenagers, granted, I'm going to give you a little bit of, you know, they be knotheadish, all right? But that's why God made you a parent, to teach them what's right and wrong. So being the right kind of dad is the kind of person who comes in and nurtures their children and shows them the way that they should go. And the way they should go is more than just having a vocation or a specific job or just being a doctor or a lawyer. It's showing them that there is a right way and a wrong way. A right way to deal with your wife, a right way to deal with life, a right way to deal with everything that's out there. We have to be the example, and they're watching the way you have your conversation. If you're that dad who comes out there, or your mom, if you're that individual who's always using profanity, I'm assure you, your children do not fall far from the tree. The apple don't fall far from a tree. A child doesn't either. So when you see these little children going around and they're using all sorts of profanity, is it because it's something they haven't heard? Either they've been sitting in front of the TV without anybody interacting and knowing what's going on in their lives? Are you using the profanity yourself? And isn't it, aren't you proud when your child goes up and uses all those little four-letter words to the preacher? Ain't that a great day? Whew, thank you, I taught him something new today. I'm proud. I'm telling you, and the reason these things happen is because there's nobody setting the example anymore. Because the priorities, and I can't change the world out here. I know that. All I want to do is plant a seed with you. Because I'm telling you, all across the country today, they're looking for things that really matter. And you have to decide what really matters. We got to have the right kind of a right kind of atmosphere in our home. And homes aren't really homes anymore. They're more like a gas station. We pull up in there, we get a little rest, and we zoom right back out of there again. Home is what matters. The reason you see the problems in our world today is because there's no such thing as a home. Because it takes a lot of responsibility. It's easy to go out there and do other stuff, but it's hard staying home. You got to let your child, that child, when they see their moms and dads, when they see them reading the Bible, and you hear them, and like even in this church, I've had people that are much older tell me how they heard their mother singing. They can still remember singing godly songs. I ain't talking about honky-tonk songs. The godly songs. I've had people say, I seen my daddy read the Bible. I've had them tell me about, I seen my daddy doing all these things. It's a great thing. Your dad fishes. I love to fish. I love going out there and doing the hunting and all that, and that's a great thing to do. But I'm telling you something, if we don't leave them a legacy of how to get to heaven, of having a true relationship, of how marriage should be, it's our fault. It's our fault. They have to see, they take that responsibility when they're growing up and they see their dad either going to church or not going to church. You might be a great person. You might be an absolutely great person. Me and you can be the best of friends. But what good does it do if you don't raise your children up to know God? I can get up here and say all sorts of pretty things about you, but what's going to matter is when you stand before Jesus Christ. We got to let them know as dads that Jesus matters to us. It's amazing to me when we do VBS, Jessica, as we was having the VBS, you know, the one thing I seen when they got up to a certain age, you know what was missing in the church? Boys. When they get around 10 years old, you don't see boys no more. And I started saying, well, why is that? Where are the boys at? Where have all the boys of summer gone? Well, they've been taught that there's something else that's more important. Now, I love baseball. I love football. I love all of it. Don't get me wrong. But I'm telling you, the reason they have practices on the nights of service is because the church let them do it. The church has let them do it. Sunday shouldn't be a debate of whether your kids are going to come to church or not. This is how you can tell when you're raising your children upright is by knowing if they understand that Sunday is a day of worship. That Sunday's a day where we go and we serve the Lord. It's not just the weddings or the funerals or Easter or Christmas. It's all about whether every single, they understand that this day is set aside to glorify God. Not playing golf and not going out there fishing, but glorifying God at the house of God where we worship and exalt Him. But I don't like this or I don't like that. Ain't that amazing? Because it's so much more than liking. It's not about the me, me, me. It's all about the him, him, him. See, that's the one who gets me through day by day. If you got a, if you had a heart attack tonight, and you're lying in the Baptist hospital up there in Jackson, stuff, and you're gulping for air, and you're pleading with God for your life, who are you going to send for? Are you going to send for your golfing buddies? Are you going to send for your fishing buddies? Are you going to send for the people of God to come pray for you? See, that's what happens. No matter the accidents, me and Ted are seeing an accident, and I've heard people hoop and holler about a lot of things, but I'm going to tell you something. What they don't call for is the things they spend the most time with. Building Christian lives needs Christian training to be in the house of God. And maybe you haven't had it. I'm not trying to beat up on you or nothing like this. I'm telling you, you can make a difference. And it begins, how's it begin? I've been all my life living this certain way where this is important and this important. Let me tell you something. Everything's going to pass away except for God. He's eternal. That house out there you take care of, it's wonderful. Praise the Lord. But you know what? One day, I don't care what it's made out of. I've seen bricks houses. I've seen all sorts of things fall apart. It matters, though, when you leave a legacy of Jesus Christ. When you're molding a child. One of the things that the world's trying to do today is mess your kids' brains up. And you know what they discovered? It wasn't 20 years ago, guys. It wasn't 20 years ago that there was a plan to start teaching your children wrong was right and right was wrong. And you know what? Here's what I hate to say it. I hate to tell you. They've succeeded. Many of you have already heard these things. So sin doesn't seem like sin anymore because you adapt. You even have people that are calling themselves preachers and different people of God who say the opposite. And we have people falling to the occult because they don't know enough scriptures. It's not because they're terrible people. They just don't know the Word of God. Families are just losing this battle. In Jacksonville, Florida, that's one of the statistics I've seen, 7 out of 10 families end in divorce. 7 out of 10? And so I guess that's why people tell their families that after you get to your second or third wife, you'll be okay. Really? Really? Sounds like a joke. Families are biting the dust. They're going down in defeat when it comes to staying in the church, staying close in relationship with Christ. See, we have to stop doing something, and it sounds offensive. I don't want to be offensive. I want to catch your ears up. We have to really understand that we're living so selfish of lives. Our lives are so selfish. We got to quit making decisions on what's in it for me. You know why the little churches collapse around here, and everybody has an opinion, and I understand it. And listen, it's not just the younger ones, too. Older ones make decisions upon what they're comfortable with, too. You see it all the time. It's not about what glorifies God. It's what I like, what I enjoy. So this isn't just about young people. So if I'm gonna make upset, let's make everybody upset. We say, this is what I like. And what that's really saying, it's all about me. It's all about what I want and when I want it. So when do you know a baby is hungry? Anybody know? I know we don't raise them no more or nothing like that, but when are they hungry? When do they need a diaper change? How can you tell? Huh. What do you hear from church people? Wah, wah, wah. Listen, I love you. But it's so important to understand it's not about me. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 1 through 7, this is what it says. Now, this is the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments which the Lord your God has commanded me to teach you, that you might do them in the land where you're going over to possess it. It's so that you and your son and your grandson might fear the Lord your God to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command you, all the days of your life, and that your days may be prolonged. O Israel, you should listen and be careful to do it, that it may be well with you, and that you may multiply greatly, just as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised you in a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. So one of the things you have to do is we have to be the teachers of our children of what's right and wrong. We have to teach the sanctity of life. We have to teach about the sanctity of marriage. We have to teach about just how holy it is. We have to teach about how why God created sex in the first place and the sanctity of marriage. We have to be pure. We have to teach them why they have to be pure. We got to teach them about the dwelling place of God on earth when we become a born-again believer, that he indwells in us. We have to teach our children to be honest. It's important that they have to be truthful, and you have to start disciplining your kids. So when do you discipline your kids? You discipline your kids, and watch this, about 2 or 3 years old. I ain't talking about beating them, but I'm going to tell you the greatest thing you can do is to spank a child. They should turn around and hug you when it's over with because you love them. You don't spank them because you're mad. When you spank them when you're mad, you got problems in the first place. You have to spank them because you have a responsibility, and you're going to be held accountable for it one day. And we have to show our children to honor their mothers and their dads. They won't know it unless you teach them. And I'm going to tell you, when little boys come up, you got to watch them. It ain't that they're terrible. They're like little bulls in the field. You got to teach them who the big bull in the field is. And you got to teach them that how they respond to your wife. They watch you when you how you treat your wife and everything. And you got to you just got to be patient because it takes all of them time to develop. You know, it's so easy to run away. And that's what most dads have done. They're runaway dads. But that house that you live in should be a home of loyalty. The love of Christ, you know what it calls us to? To be loyal. Don't call your wife old woman. You know, people got, you know, they were bothered because I didn't want to smack my wife in the face with a pie. But I measure it. I'm not telling you everything's wrong. I'm just saying for me. I measure it. I measure it because I want the children to know it's important. It's a good thing to have fun. I ain't going to tell you that's wrong. But it's important on how you treat your family. Today, dads, you make a difference. You're important. You're very important. So as Brother Raymond comes forward here with all the music players, here's the thing. Are you prepared to meet your maker? You get that part down pat first. Because if you ain't, don't make some preacher get up there and lie over you. Next thing is, if you're prepared to meet your maker, are you raising your children to know the maker? That's important. That's eternal. And that is what's going to matter when it's all said and done. Today is this altar call. This is for you. As the Holy Spirit leads you, if you want to come pray, come pray. Forget your watch for just a minute. You ain't even going to have services tonight. And I know y'all was all planning on coming. You ain't going to have service. This altar call is for you. Let the Holy Spirit speak to your heart today.
Won't you come
right now?
I surrender.
These altars are open.
All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily.
Thank you so much for every dad that's here today, God, to get up and bring their families to church. What a glorious day it is, Father, to be in your house, to sing praises to your name. I ask that you bless them, May they have a fabulous day, Lord, enjoying the time with their dads. And Lord, may we always remember the legacy that our dads have left us, Father. And Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that we will raise up generations to come to know you as Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. God bless all y'all.